Thank you. We're going to continue in our sermon series, A Room with a View, looking at these high spaces and hard places, especially in the life of Abraham. I want to invite you to Genesis chapter 15. I want to read just the first few verses of this chapter as we join Abram here in what today will be known as the waiting room. Genesis chapter 15, beginning in verse 1, I'll be reading from the NRSV. This is the word of God for you, the people of God. After these things, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. But Abram said, O Lord God, what will you give me? For I continue childless. And the heir of my house is Eleazar of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no offspring, and so a slave born in my house is to be my heir. But the word of the Lord came to him. This man shall not be your heir. No one but your very own shall be your heir. Then God brought Abram outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars if you are able to count them. Then God said to him, so shall your descendants be. And Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him as righteousness. God, would you pour through me your gifts of story, of preaching, and imagination as we enter into this room, the waiting room, a room filled with wonder, but also a room filled with great frustration. We give you this time, for it's in your name that we pray. Amen. As I was reading the text this week, I was reminded of one of my favorite quotes from a good friend of mine who also preaches. And my preacher friend said, he really struggles with people who say when God closes one door, God always opens another, but no one ever warns you how long the hallway is. You see, Abram this morning is in the hallway. Abram is waiting for this open door, and that's a hard place to be, waiting. And unfortunately, we know waiting all too well. Waiting can be trivial, as far as waiting in line for your food, waiting at a light, or even waiting on something in the microwave. Waiting could be a little more serious, as far as waiting for a job, or waiting for a test score, or even waiting for that day that you can finally retire. But waiting can also be more critical. When you are waiting for test results from cancer, or when you're waiting for an unemployment check, or you're waiting for that family member to make a better choice, or consider this week how many, many Americans are waiting for the conscience of those wrapped in a lighter colored skin to pay attention to those wrapped in darker colored skin. And we're waiting for racism to finally end in this country. Waiting is so painful. But waiting isn't always painful. Waiting can be filled with good things. Waiting for a grandchild. Waiting for Christmas to come. Waiting for summer vacation. We hope, right? And yet when it comes to matters of faith, when God doesn't just shut a door, but slams the door shut, waiting in the hallway can be one of the greatest challenges to our faith. Abram is in the hallway. He is seated in the waiting room this morning. And God comes and says, Abram, you need to continue to wait. You see, Abram is living from this promise that was made in the meeting room where God came and met with Abram and said, Abram, if you'll just leave your family, your country, and go to this land I will show you, I will make your descendants great. But wait. Abram takes his family and they journey through this long process and they come upon this beautiful land, but Lot and his herdsmen begin to fight and they end up separating, but there's still no child. Even in the chapter before this, we discover that Lot is captured by enemies only to be rescued by his uncle Abram, and yet there's still no child. Wait. Abram's hallway is brutal. And what's so unfortunate is the voice that we don't even hear in chapter 15, the voice of Abram's wife, Sarai, who seems to be barren. The door is shut, but God says, wait. And you know how that feels. I know how that feels. So God comes and announces to Abram, Abram, do not be afraid. I am your shield. Your reward shall be very great. I am your shield. Abram, I am. And then Abram chooses to believe. But I think the belief is not just some, okay, I'll go for it, but it's rather a tremendous risk that Abram takes. And so the question that sat with me all week as I tried to imagine myself sitting in this waiting room with Abram is this: is belief in the waiting room a risk worth taking? Is this really something that believers should embrace? When you can't see what's in front of you, because what's in front of you is so desolate and so filled with opportunities for depression, when all hope seems to be gone, is belief worth taking a risk? And this morning, I want us to join Abram and say, yes. Belief in Abram's God that has been revealed through the story of Scripture and has been made true through the person and work of Jesus Christ and now lives in you by the presence of the Holy Spirit. That's a risk worth taking. So let's sing, let's respond, and let's choose to believe.
Thank you, Beth. I love being a witness to your gifts and the gifts of so many here in our church family. The comma or the pause in our life, it reminds me that God is the author of this story. God is the main character of the story of Abram. In other words, God is writing the story and Abram is a character. It's not the other way around. And I wonder sometimes if we get lost in the story of Abram, who later becomes Abraham, and we get so lost in this commitment of faith that we forget that this is not Abram's story. This is God's story that Abram gets to be a part of. Abram chooses to live into this mission, this adventure that God calls him into. And then in verse 6 of our text, Abram believed the Lord, and the Lord reckoned it to him, or credited it to him as righteousness. Don't you think that's a little unfair? That here we have Abram, and he's gone through so much, and he's in the hallway, and he's sitting in the waiting room, and he needs a child, not a slave, he needs a legitimate heir to all the promises that God has promised to give. And yet the child is nowhere to be found. It's nowhere in sight. Abram's biological clock, Sarah's biological clock, are doing them no favors. And so God leads Abram outside and he looks up at the stars and then he believed the Lord. But I think there has to be more to this story. There has to be more than just simply Abram shrugging his shoulders and saying, okay, I believe. Because that's not how faith works. God comes to Abram. God is the initiator of this conversation. Abram chooses to listen. The word of the Lord came to Abram twice. The word of the Lord came, and when the word of the Lord comes, you have a choice of whether to listen or not. And as we've just sung, Abram took the risk to believe that what God was going to say was in fact true. But I don't want us to lose sight that the mission of God begins with God making an invitation. And God says, Abram, I am. I am your shield. I am your reward. I am. Does that sound familiar? This great invitation for God to say, this is who I am, before God ever says anything about what God does. It happens with Moses in Exodus chapter 3. When Moses is there in the burning bush, and before God ever tells Moses what Moses is going to do, God says, this is who I am. It happens again with Gideon in Judges chapter 6. It happens with Mary in the Second Testament. God always says, you've got to believe in who I am before you get too excited or anxious about what I will do. So the reality of the waiting room from Abram this morning is Abram is invited to believe who God is. And that comes before God does. God is always comes before God does throughout the story of Scripture. When Moses is asked to lead God's people out of slavery, it doesn't begin with how. It doesn't begin with what. It doesn't even begin with why. It begins with who God is. And as the gathered people of God, wherever you are sitting, you have the opportunity to join Abram in the waiting room and say, yes, God, this is who you are. And I'm going to take the risk and believe that you're bigger, that you're greater. I like what one author says, that God is always going to be bigger than your idea of God. God is, always comes before God does. Let's sing. I love that last line of Kevin's poem. The question is not when the wait is over, but who it is that holds this wait with us. You see, that's what God is trying to do for Abram in this waiting room, assuring Abram that he's not alone. You know, there's two realities about Abram's waiting room that I noticed this week that I think might be helpful to you in those waiting rooms of your life, whether it's waiting on a family member or waiting on, well, fill in the blank. It could be trivial, critical, or of course, something that is very, very serious. But the first reality is this. God just doesn't come to Abram every single day. These aren't ongoing daily conversations that God has with Abram. I don't think God is walking with Abram and having coffee with Abram each morning as he wakes up and walks out of his tent. No, I think we get snapshots, episodes of God coming to Abram and communicating. Did you notice the first line of chapter 15? After these things. After what things? Well, after a lot of life has been lived, God comes to Abram in a vision. It's not a daily occurrence. This happens, I don't know, just a few times over the great span of Abram's life. Part of the difficulty of the waiting room and wondering where God is and if God is going to have a word is knowing that God does in fact speak, but it's not on your timetable. It's on God's. So the invitation for Abram is not to look forward, but rather to look back. I mean, how else is Abram supposed to know that God is like a shield, that God will reward Abram? It's only because the invitation is for Abram to look back. Isn't that what we say? Hindsight is always 20/20. I mean, there are several things in my life. If I had a redo, boy, I would go back and redo them again. And then, of course, we thought, well, we never learn anything. And, well, God molds us in the process. Well, of course. But I want to invite you to where Abram is this morning. Listen to what Abram says. God, what will you give me? For I continue childless. Abram says, you have given me nothing. Think about the tone of those questions. Is this like Abram rubbing the genie in a lamp and out of deep fear and great caution, he says, well, God, if you're not too busy, I'd love for you to bless me with a child. No, I think this is more like a conversation with a good friend who's made a promise and the promise has not come true. And I think there's an edge to Abram's voice. God, what are you going to give me? And I think that's appropriate. Rightfully so. Why? Because Abram has been so faithful. He's left everything. He's gone and rescued his nephew. He's done everything God has asked. And it's right for Abram to say, okay, isn't it my turn? But God says, wait. Wait. Look back. After all, in chapters 12 and 13, Abram builds an altar. Isn't it interesting that we just maybe just glance over that? But why does Abram build an altar? Abram builds an altar so that he can go back and remember what God has already done. You see, the invitation for Abram in the waiting room is to look where God has been, not just where Abram wants God to be. And that's hard. It's hard to look back rather than to look forward, because looking forward is filled with anticipation. And it's hard to look back when what is right in front of us can be so painful and so hard and so difficult. But isn't this what the Hebrew writer does in chapter 11 in the Second Testament when he says, I want you to look back at how God has been faithful to all of these people. What makes you think God won't be faithful to you? And by the way, the work that I've done through my Son, Jesus the Christ, He's the author and the perfecter of your faith. It's not about where God will be. In the waiting room, it's about the invitation to look at where God has been, not just where we want God to be. So we've sat with Abram in the waiting room, in the hallway, as the door appears to be shut and shut pretty firmly. But there's this moment in the story that captured my imagination. It's the moment where Abram looks up at the stars. Verse 5 says that God brought him outside and said, look toward heaven and count the stars if you're able to count them. Then God said to Abram, so shall your descendants be. So God brought him outside. Isn't it interesting that God brings Abram outside? And of course, the reason why is so that Abram could look at the stars. But what if it were more than just a stargazing experience? What if God was bringing Abram outside because there was so much inside of Abram's life that he couldn't see. And it's only when God brings Abram out and says, look up. Look up and be lost at the greatness of who I am. Look up and notice who I am. And Abram, I want to invite you to just set aside all of your questions of when and why and what and how, and just look up. What would it look like if you simply looked up in those moments of waiting, in those moments of being in the hallway? If God was inviting you to trust the who before the what, the when, or the how, what does this look like? I think it looks like life that you live every day. But for some of us, especially like this next person in the Highland Oaks family, the waiting can be, oh, so painful. Let's turn our attention to this wonderful and brave interview by a mother here at the Highland Oaks Church.
Well, we're here this morning in the waiting room with my dear friend Atesh Stahl, whose husband Mike is, of course, one of our shepherds, and she and Mike are just wonderful members here at Highland Oaks. And more importantly today, Atesh is a mom of some beautiful young men, but in particular this morning, I've invited her to talk about the waiting room with their oldest son, Avery. So, Atesh, thank you so much for joining us. And I just want you to start by just maybe giving us a brief overview of kind of where Avery found himself at the end of high school, towards the beginning of college, and how you got to the waiting room to begin with.
Avery was a model son. He was a firstborn. He was just everything I wanted in a son. And he breezed through high school in the first 3 years of college at Texas A&M. No issues whatsoever. It was wonderful. After he started his fourth year, which he only had about a year and a half left to finish, we got an email out of what seemed like out of the blue to us. And in the email, it stated that he had withdrew from school and had moved to California. And I'm going to live here and eventually transfer to school out here in UC Santa Barbara. And it was just very like, this is, you know, what I've done. We didn't respond to the email right away because we were in shock trying to process it. So when he contacted us and we did not just act excited about it like he was, and we had a lot of questions and a lot of concerns, and he just immediately cut us off and just shut us out of his life. He blocked us from phone, from Facebook. He just kind of basically estranged himself from us. And the only way we could communicate with him was via email. And we couldn't get anywhere with him. He was irrational and hostile, and it seemed like he was just had been brainwashed.
Wow. Now, when you say he cut you off, how long did that last, Atesh? Are we talking a few weeks, a few months, or how long was that period of time?
Well, all in all, the estrangement was 3 years.
Wow.
Because we did have some email communication with him that time. So
he didn't come home for Christmas or Thanksgiving or
no.
Wow.
No birthday, Mother's Day, Father's Day, when he didn't want to have anything to do with us.
Wow. Talk to me about some of those emotions over those 3 years. As we've talked about this morning about being in the waiting room and Abraham and Sarah just longing for things to work out on their own timetable. And I think there's some pretty fair comparisons, but part of the problem with the biblical stories, we don't get a lot of the emotions. So help us understand from a mother's perspective, what were some emotions that you felt as you were waiting to hear from Avery?
In the beginning, it was just utter confusion because we just could not understand why he was being this way, but I just wasn't really processing it fully because I just kept thinking, oh, he's going to snap out of it. Oh, he's going to get to his senses. He's going to come to his senses. His eyes are going to be open and he's going to come back to us. And so I didn't really process it like in a full grief for a while when it would just set in that he's not here. When we had Christmas, he wasn't there. When he didn't come home for, you know, he wasn't home for spring break, summer, all those milestones that you're used to having, spending with your family. So then it became kind of like desperation where I was like trying to do everything in my power to affect him, you know. And then it got to the point where he moved from California to Colorado, and we went to Colorado to go on some business. And when we were there, we tried to reach out to him to see if we could see him, and he rejected us again and said no. At that point, we got to the point of it was just desolation. It felt almost like a funeral. We realized that it's just not going to happen. And although I tried to hold on to hope, you know, we viewed him as the prodigal son. And so we kept saying, okay, there's hope. He knows the Lord. He'll come back. And so I had hope. But then I would think, he may not come back in my lifetime.
Wow.
I may not see it. You know, it may not be a happy ending for me. And so that was sad also.
Yeah. Where was God in the midst of all this, Atish? Because I know you and Mike, obviously, as a shepherding couple at Highland Oaks, you're people of faith. And just walk us just briefly and without invading any of your privacy, of course. Where was God in the midst of this?
I didn't feel like God was doing this to me or to us because I know that we have free will and God does not control us. And therefore, I did not blame God for what was happening. I begged him and pleaded with him all the time, you know, for a miracle, for intervention. Even though we were in a valley, I was in a valley, I still was faithful. I still felt like, you know, I didn't want to like throw away my faith.
Yeah.
It was just a valley and just a, like I said, it was kind of a desolation.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I really appreciate your honesty, Atish. Thank you so much for interviewing with us and sharing that painful story. And I know that for those that aren't parents, they may not be able to relate to not knowing where your child is and those words like desolation. But I think everyone can certainly relate to being in a valley and having a choice of whether you're going to live into that obedience or not. So just really appreciate your honesty. Thanks for joining us this morning.
You're welcome.
I don't know of many more powerful testimonies than of a mother who has been waiting for a child to come home. Did you hear the words desolation, despair? You see, those are the realities of the waiting room. And one of the reasons why we're dwelling in this story from Genesis 15 is because the story doesn't have a nice, neat ending. It ends with more waiting. And this morning, we have no assurances that everything's going to work out. But the only assurance we do have is that it all belongs to God. Salvation is not in your hand, and it's not in my hand. Salvation belongs to our God. This is one of the most powerful anthems we sing together here at the Highland Oaks Church. It's a declaration to say, it's not about us, and it's not about our wanting and our wins and our whys. It is about God. So let's join together and sing. Salvation belongs to our God who sits on the throne and unto the Lamb forever and ever. Amen. Let those who have ears to hear the words of God.